Good evening. I want to say that I've enjoyed leading the hymn session prior to the service. I appreciate you all coming and participating. So if you have a selection, we'll do that for our first number. What? 41? 41. I guess I'm getting hard of hearing. Did you hear the selection chosen was 41? I think we'll sing all three verses, please. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Has a selection?
Number 12.
Okay, thank you. Number 12. That's I think we will sing three verses, please. First, second, and fourth. Song unless I think of Fred Long, so I dedicate that in his memory. Do I have another selection, please? In the garden. the favorite hymn.
Shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Soon you, stand.
get a selection? How about 49? Because he lives, we too shall live. Time for one more. 33. Is this come into my heart, Lord Jesus? Into my heart, into my heart, come into my heart.
I don't think I know that.
No, I don't think I don't think the organist knows that.
But I got it.
He has it.
I have something different.
Well, I think this is it. I think that we're okay, we'll try it. Do you want to sing just the chorus? I apologize for this. Let's sing the chorus. One verse and one chorus of 34 at the cross, and then we'll start the service, I think. Ready to start our evening service.
Victory in Jesus.
Huh? Victory in Jesus. All right. The name of it is Victory in Jesus, and I do believe that you have that in your bulletin. I want to hear you singing now real good.
Save. unto me.
You may be seated. This evening we will be concluding with the formal services of Lent, witnesses to the journey in faith. And there are of two kinds. The first kind is a witness from our own congregation, because we are all part of a royal priesthood. We are all responsible for teaching and for preaching and for sharing the good news of the gospel, the good news in Jesus the Christ. But also, tonight we have with us a person who has spent years in the pastorate, who is now the current pastor of the Patterson Park Baptist Church, and who's done a great job in building that church in the community, and with whom we share a collegiate relationship as brothers in the faith. So we're going to hear from Bill George, and he's going to tell us a little bit about his own struggle with faith and how he became a Christian and a Baptist, and why he's there at his church right on Eastern Avenue. And so today we're going to begin having Cass tell us a little bit about her faith. Cass Young, who is our one of our secretaries and been a member of this church for years and years, and it's an honor to have Cass here. She's such a kind, loving person, and she really does take care of me, and I really appreciate that, as I did Henry. I was feeling a little wobbly this evening, so Henry was right there. Give me a hand. Okay, go ahead. Go ahead, you know, we'll sit down.
Good evening. My parents started me on my journey in faith by seeing that I was baptized, went to Sunday school, and was confirmed here at United. I am grateful for parents who kept their commitment to bring me up in the knowledge of the Lord. They raised 8 children and made sure every one of them went to Sunday school and were confirmed. After confirmation, I weaned away from the church. I returned to get married and brought my children here to be baptized, sent them to Sunday school, and had them confirmed. But at this time, I was not an active member. During my teen years and my 20s, I felt I didn't need to go to church regularly. I said my prayers at night and called on God when I really needed Him during this time of my life. When I hit my 30s, I really fell from the grace of God. I became so lost spiritually that I didn't really understand at the time what was happening to me. I thought God turned his back on me and was punishing me for the things I thought I did wrong, but I realized that it was I who did the turning. I was trying to raise three children and dealing with the effects of the disease of alcoholism. I was fortunate at that time to find a 12-step program in Al-Anon, a support group for spouses of those who were dealing with the disease of alcoholism. Through the program, I began to slowly regain my faith, and I returned to church. At first, I went to several different churches because I wasn't sure if I wanted to stay here at United or what the Lord wanted from me. Then one Christmas Eve, sitting in the balcony of this church, I prayed to God for forgiveness in my part dealing with this problem of alcoholism and for me to find a way back in his grace. He touched me with his spirit, and I was born again in my faith. What a wonderful experience it was when I found the Lord again. My life took on a new meaning. My whole life changed. I was able to find a better way of life. I was very thankful for this and decided to continue on my journey here at United. I have had ups and downs in my faith since then, but every time I do, my faith becomes stronger. In late October of 1997, I decided to go off the medication that I was taking because I felt it wasn't helping me anymore. I didn't understand what was happening to me again. I couldn't even motivate for 3 days. I really needed faith in my Lord more than ever. Nights and all through the days, I prayed for help and guidance. Through my faith, I was led to the right doctors and the right medication. I thank God every day for his concern for me. I praise him and thank him for helping me. There are many people in the church who has helped me in my journey. I am grateful for them. Like Pastor says, finish the race and keep the faith, and that's what I intend to do. Thank you.
And I'll tell you, since she met the Lord and received him into her whole life has changed in terms of solving problems and the happiness and joy that she radiates in our office, and we're terribly thankful to the Lord Jesus for that. You know, it's interesting, when the doctor gives you a medication, he may be doing the work of healing for Christ, you see, and in the process of doing that work of healing, he may not even know Jesus' name. But we know that he's working for Christ, because all healing is done in the name of Christ, whether it's a therapist or the dietary people in the hospital or the people who are the doctors and the nurses, the surgeons and that sort of thing. They're all working for the Lord, even if they do not know his name, because this is the great gift of modern medicine, which really stems and is driven by and comes out of the work of the Lord Jesus in the first century. And now we're gonna listen to a man who knows something about illness and about health and about a whole bunch of wonderful things, and he's going to surprise me today, he said. So I would love to have George Finnerty come forward and present his witness.
When I was first asked to participate in the Witness to Faith program, I was slightly hesitant in fear I would not be able to express myself properly. But after giving it some thought, I decided to make an effort to explain what my life in the church has meant to me. I was baptized in our church in 1927. And confirmed in 1942 by our beloved pastor, Reverend Titus Lehman. My participation in the church was very limited in the early years of my life, due primarily to being away most of the time, either in the U.S. Navy, the Merchant Marine, or fighting forest fires in California. In 1960, after 16 years of traveling around the world, I returned home to start over again where I left off back in 1944. I settled down, found an apartment, and went to work locally, occasionally attending church, but only on a very limited basis. I was living the lifestyle I had developed over my years of traveling around the world, which meant I left God out of a big portion of my life. Selfishly catering to my own satisfactions and avoiding the responsibilities that a Christian must make if he is to live within the life of his church. During this period, nothing changed very much, since I was perfectly content in living as I always had, stubbornly resisting any efforts to change my ways. In other words, I was a hard-headed Irishman who thought only of himself. My life took a sudden and dramatic turn in April 1988 when my stepfather, Walter B. Schaefer, died suddenly from a massive heart attack. I never had the same kind of love for Walter that I had for my real father, but he had been married and cared for my mother for over 30 years, and I loved and had deep respect for him for that. The passing of Walter left my mother, who was 85 years old then, to live alone in her home, and I knew she was having great difficulty in dealing with this. I decided to move in with my mother, and with the help of my three sisters, made life as comfortable as possible. We all knew in our hearts that is what Mom prayed for, to have her family near her, and it made her grief so much easier to cope with. Mom loved her church, so it became my obligation to make sure she got there every Sunday. On Sunday mornings, we dressed for church, usually went to breakfast at Denny's, simply because my mother liked the waitresses who served us there. Then we attended the 10:30 service. So you might say that my mother was very instrumental in my returning to the church on a regular basis. Then out of the blue, something happened that changed my entire attitude. I was asked to become a member of the church council. It came as a complete surprise, and I explained that even though I felt I was not qualified, I would do the best I could if the congregation voted me in. When you become a council member, your attitude towards the congregation changes, since you become more personally involved in any concerns they may have in relation to the church. During my 6 years on the council, I had the good fortune of coming in close contact with many members of our congregation that developed into a deep respect for their dedication to our church. To mention their names is never necessary, since these people are not searching for recognition and only obtain real satisfaction from being able to serve the Lord and our church. As another example of dedication, there's a grand lady in our church who spent 50 years of her life teaching the life of Jesus to children in our Sunday school. And she did it very quietly and with great dignity. How much more love can anyone give? When you read about our beginning in 1873, right up to the present day, our church has always been blessed with more than our share of talented and dedicated men and women who unselfishly gave of themselves in service to the church. But when it came to our sour beef and dumpling dinners, it was the women who always carried our banner with pride. And with their hard-working hands and their stubborn fortitude, were always head and shoulders above any competition that dared to test them. The memory of all these people and their loyalty will always be a reminder of what life in our church is really all about. I slowly came to realize the vast difference there is when you live with God than when you exist without Him. I had been very foolish and selfish to have let all those precious years go by with allowing Jesus to be there to guide me. It's never too late to accept Christ, so I try to improve my personal relationship with Jesus by being honest about my faults and strengthen my faith by my silent prayers. Whenever I take communion now, I no longer feel that twinge of guilt as I look up at the carving of the Last Supper above the altar. For I know that Jesus would never consider anyone unworthy who came to sit at his table, but that his love and understanding is always there for every one of us. I can't see how anyone who has ever been a witness to all the wonderful things we love about our church to not stand up for Jesus. As the dawn of the 21st century approaches, we will be stepping into it with the golden opportunity to rededicate our life and our faith and walk the remaining days of our life on this earth in the strong but gentle and caring hands of our Father, realizing deep in our heart and soul that this long journey of faith that we travel is not almost over, but that it is just beginning. Amen.
Thank you so much, George. And I think you'll never fully appreciate all the times that you've touched people in the church through your work on the council, but also through your work as an individual human being. We got surprised one day when we were asked to come to George's house after his mom died. We came and he prepared a wonderful meal for us. He told us about his work as a smoke jumper and told us about his work as a merchant seaman working in the seas of the North Atlantic, which were so rough that even when the ship was on full tilt ahead, it was going backwards. So George is a person who's also been in California and up in Anchorage, Alaska, but he's had a wonderful faith journey. But all of these experiences he's handled because I'm sure that he recognizes that the Lord was walking with him at every moment in time. Now let us join together now in singing the second hymn. Thank you. may be seated. Good evening. You are the survivors, the people who can transcend the weather. Weather always is one of our most difficult obstacles that seems to me to get over. But anyhow, we welcome you to the evening Lenten service. It's the last of the series of the Journey in Faith. And we want to call your attention to the fact that next week we are going to reenact the tableau which you find behind the altar. And those disciples there are going to tell us something about their journey in faith as they followed Jesus. And we will be able to experience what it must have been like to be there at that first Lord's Supper communion. We want to say that this Sunday we're going to have a blessing of the palms at 9:15 down at O'Donnell Square, hoping to have our confirmants there. They're coming for their examination tomorrow, and if everything goes well and they pass and they get their pictures taken and so forth, then they can come and help us with other churches and with anybody from our church who wants to come and join us for the blessing of the palms. We all take palms and we go and home singing the same song. Isn't that wonderful? And then on Good Friday, we will be carrying the cross immediately after our Good Friday service at 9 a.m. Over at St. Bridget's, stopping for each church and praying for that church. And then there is a three-hour special service at the Second Congregational Church, a three-hour service on Good Friday, which you're all invited to. We'll have a chance to hear pastors. Pastor Jolenbeck is going to represent us at that three-hour service. And then we want to remind you that on Saturday we're having a communion service here at 8:30. It's supposed to be men's communion and breakfast, but today men love to have the women come and join them for communion, and then breakfast will be at 9 o'clock. Remember that we have refreshments immediately after the service tonight, and we're very pleased to have with us Pastor William George. Let us return to the Lord a portion of that which we have received from him, remembering that he gives us every good gift, including the life which we share together. Thank you. Let us pray. Into thy hands, our Heavenly Father, we commit these gifts, remembering that they are but a small portion of the gifts of life and love which you have given us. Guide the hands that use them, that they may be used to proclaim the gospel throughout this community and throughout the world. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. I've been reminded again that the Easter services consist of three services. One, a sunrise service at 6 o'clock, which we'll be doing with Father Joe from St. Bridget's Church. And then we have a 9 o'clock service called the Living Cross, where we rebuild a cross with daffodils and carnations. It's a wonderful experience, especially for the children, but all the adults are cordially invited. And then at 10 o'clock, instead of 10:30, as it was in the bulletin last Sunday, we'll have the Easter service right here at United Evangelical. Now, one of the things we've been thinking about and thinking about the journey of faith is how beautiful are the people who journey in faith and who follow Jesus. And you know, when you hear George and you hear Cass, you see two absolutely beautiful people, but their faith is the thing that makes them radiate and shine like stars, and that's what it means being the light of the world. Well, Isaiah came a long time before Jesus, and this is what he said about those who follow him. This is from the 52nd chapter of Isaiah, verses 7 to 10. And this applies, of course, to Bill George, who's been doing this every Sunday for years. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of the messenger who announces peace, who brings good news, who announces salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. Listen, your sentinels lift up their voices. Together they sing for joy, for in plain sight they see the return of the Lord to Zion. Break forth together into singing, you ruins of Jerusalem, for the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. The Lord has bared his holy arm before the eyes of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of our God. The word of the Lord. Bill, we welcome you now. Evangelical, and I guess before we have your message, we're going to go right into the message right now. you have to excuse me. I was doing a lot of packing today, and I'm not functioning too well. Thanks to Henry, I made it up here.
I want to thank you for the invitation and the opportunity to come and share tonight, and I want to thank Pastor Armstrong for the opportunity to share, because it truly is that we are a community of different people, and our gifts put together, we advance the cause of Christ within our community and then into our state and throughout the world. And so it's an opportunity to share those journeys that we may learn from one another. And I'm thankful for the witnesses before that shared their journeys and their stories, because that's just what they are, real and personal, and they give us that witness. We sang, "Where He Leads, I'll Follow." That hymn's very, very special to me. I appreciate Rob asking me what hymns tonight and what I would be interested. The first was very much a very good Baptist hymn, Victory in Jesus. But the second, Where He Leads, I'll Follow. That was the hymn that I accepted God's call to go into full-time Christian service. And it took me from Baltimore down to North Carolina, then to Virginia, and then God in his wisdom saw fit to call me back home to Baltimore, where I've been, and I'm in my eighth year now, back at Patterson Park Baptist Church. So when I hear that song sung, I don't know, each of us, I think, have songs, hymns that touch our souls and deal with. That one I take very seriously, because wherever God chooses to call me, I've promised to follow and take a look. So that hymn was there because it's very, very special to me. I would like to read a passage of scripture. It comes from the book of John, the Gospel of John, the 10th chapter. The good news that is shared here. It says, I tell you the truth, man who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The man who enters by the gate is the shepherd of his sheep. The watchman opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him, because they know his voice. And that's what I've sought to do, because Jesus Christ is that shepherd, and I have sought to follow his voice wherever he leads. I was very fortunate growing up. I had Christian parents, Christian grandparents, and so I literally was enrolled in what was the cradle role of the church long before I was ever born. But there I was from the day one in the church. And I give thanks for parents that were faithful and that were willing to bring me up in the admonition and nurture of the Lord. I accepted Jesus Christ as personal Savior and Lord at the age of 9. And I followed him in baptism at that time. I hit those high school years, and I wasn't so sure that I wanted to be a Baptist. I wasn't so sure that I fully understood what was going on or necessarily agreed, but I continued to ask questions. When I went to college, my father, who was very wise, said, I don't care where you go, just go. Put your faith to practice. Find that place that suits your needs. I was a student at Johns Hopkins University at that time, and so I was going across to the churches within the area of Johns Hopkins University. I got a BA and a master's degree in education, and I had the opportunity to work at the university for 10 years. I ended up working in educational research. And one of the things that I learned is that I believe that everybody should fulfill their potential. And at that time, I was trying to help young people and children fulfill all their potentiality that they have, their ability to do their best, whatever it might be. When I was called into the ministry, it didn't change. Only I was encouraging people to fulfill their call in Christ and to be all that they could be through Jesus Christ, who does give us that ability and that potentiality. I was in a program and I had a lot of success. And I somehow managed to juggle that point. And I was married after graduating, about a year afterward. And children came along, and somehow I tried to juggle work and church and family and all the different things. But when I reflect back, God didn't have first priority in my life. I can say that now. I couldn't see it at the time. But as I got working and as I went the way and ended up starting my own research program and developing it and got the first grants, and it's a program now that has its own building at Hopkins and has $17 million a year budget. But there I was, and I decided people were more important than money. And I was having some big arguments with the high powers to be, and I wanted to help children and help young people and families. So I took a paid leave of absence. In some ways, I'd say it was the most miserable time of my life, and yet it was probably the most joyous. I started getting involved in my local church, I had gone and had been involved, but I had the time to become Sunday school director, had the time to really act as a minister of education there within the local church, doing it on a volunteer basis and not really knowing that I was serving as a minister in that capacity. But my wife said she knew I was called to the ministry, to full-time Christian service. She knew it. My pastor knew it. Not me. I said, sometimes I'm a little bit bullheaded. And I sometimes think the Lord needs to use a 2x4 a few dozen times across the side of the head to get my attention because I don't always listen real well. And I had many a door close and job opportunities. My wife wasn't so sure she was happy. There was Missouri, Arkansas, New Mexico, always one of two, but never quite getting the position that I thought. And then there came that night in July that I accepted Christ's call, God's call, to full-time Christian service. And I went forward on that hymn to the front of the church, and I shared it. I'll never forget my parents, both of them crying. My wife was crying, and I thought, and I just didn't know quite what to say, but my wife knew and my pastor knew what was up. But I take a look back at those years at Hopkins. I was senior administrative staff, and if I was still there today, my children, I wouldn't have to worry about college tuition for my kids that are in college or anything else. But God saw fit to use those experiences to prepare me. I had the opportunity to write and edit books, and as a result, I've been able to write in the area of faith development and children in crisis and dealing in that area. And so God uses those experiences. When I went, I didn't know where I was going. I didn't know quite what to do, and I went to seminary studies program. But I knew I wanted to help people to be all that they could be in Jesus Christ, to help them fulfill their potential. I went to seminary, and I graduated first in my seminary class. But I'll never forget being frustrated again, because as the time came for graduation and I was looking for that position that God would lead me to, the door always closed, and I didn't quite know where it was going. And the president of the seminary said, "Bill, I need to remind you that for every door that shuts, a window springs open. Think about it." He was also the one that says, take the time to smell the roses. Take the time to experience God right where you are and to take a look. You have to appreciate, my wife had knee surgery while we were there. She was in an elevator accident, had knee reconstruction. And here I saw the faculty and others just show God's love. One of them had the bathtub ministry. Now that's going to sound, you're going to wonder why she had knee surgery, needed to be in a bathtub. We had shower doors that slid and you couldn't get into the bathtub. So one of those faculty members opened the door of their home and said, use the bathtub. They would leave their house, always made sure there was plenty of snacks and goodies in the refrigerator and that there was all this to deal with. And they would call and periodically, I didn't want to say anything, and they'd say, don't you think it's about time that Di went over there? My only embarrassment was when they went to dinner with another set of friends and they said, well, we've started the bathtub ministry, and everybody knew what it was about because it was for Di and her knee. But God blessed and used that door to take a look. I thought I was going into full-time Christian education, a minister of education, an associate pastor or something in the area of education. But I had a faculty member who said, I visited a church that I believe needs you because they need a minister, pastor with an education heart to encourage discipling and growing and nurturing. That church called me and loved me in spite of my mistakes and other things, but it was a learning experience and dealing. And so I went to a little rural community, 12,000 in the county. That's a little bit different than Baltimore, wouldn't you say? It was an hour away from Richmond, Virginia. You could see deer all over the place. There were two stoplights in the entire town and four in the entire county. Slightly different. The county next to us had no stoplights. My kids loved it. And then when I said, well, we're going back to Baltimore, that God's called us there, my son says, I don't think I want to go. I said, well, you don't have a whole lot of choice in that, and I'm sorry. And I had to look at the busyness and the pace and say, God, do you really want me here? But God knew what he was doing. And he knew that urban ministry was where I needed to be. And he gave me a burden for people. Because wherever I've been, I've always taken a look at seeing needs. Not can you meet them, but how do we meet them? Lord, you've given us that opportunity. A need's an opportunity. Now how can we minister in the name of Christ? So that's my journey, and it brought me here. But there again, we come as people of faith, but we have different perspectives. I'm a Baptist, a Southern Baptist. What made me decide on being a Southern Baptist? I can't say that my parents forced it on me, or did they either. They nurtured it. Yes, they have been Baptist. I grew up in a community that basically looked at me and they said, you're what? There were a lot of Methodist, there were a lot of Catholic, some Lutheran, Baptist. And then they would tell me, well, Baptists don't believe this, and Baptists don't do this, and Baptists don't do that. And I used to say, oh, wait a minute. And then I got to the point of saying, my faith's not based on negatives of what I don't do. It's based on what I believe. And as I went about it, I can take a look now and say, well, yes, I think I know what caused me to be a Baptist in dealing with it. If you know me, I'm one that tends to color outside the lines. I like that freedom of expression. I like to encourage people to say, well, can't you do it another way? Or is that the only way? I'm willing to try something new and be a bit of a risk taker. Baptists believe in the autonomy of the local church. Somebody has defined it as one step on a banana peel because the church can say tomorrow, bye. We don't have a denomination that we have to report to. The church calls us and says, we believe you're the person that's being led to this church, much as I can say to the church that I feel that my ministry is over there, that I'm being called to another place of service. And so that, I think, has had important, that ability to make the choice and decision and dealing with it. A second aspect that I really think that was important for me was what we call priesthood of the believer. I don't need someone to intercede for me when I pray. I can pray directly to God. God gives me revelation. He gives each of us revelation, I believe. He speaks to us and deals with us from Scripture, and we can learn from one another. And also there's that no difference between clergy and laity. We all are ministers in Christ's name. My role as pastor is to equip the saints for the work of the ministry that each of us are called to do. And so for me, that's a very important piece, and I think as I look back to it, that's what brought me there and encouraged me. You see, I had the opportunity growing up, I was in Scouts, and was a Nickel Scout, and was involved, and there were three churches that were right close. There wasn't a Baptist church that had a Scout troop. There was a Catholic church, a Lutheran church, and a Methodist church. I happened to go to the Lutheran church, but one of the things that we did together all the time, even when it wasn't there, we did services together, very ecumenical. We did things together as the three troops, and we would talk about our beliefs and our faith, and we would come together, and while there might be separations in the church itself, when we were at camp and we were worshiping or dealing, there was no separation, but it caused me to take a look. When I was in high school, there was Young Life, and then there were Youth for Christ, and a number of ecumenical opportunities. The chaplain, when I was at Hopkins, was the husband of my English teacher in high school. Now, he and I didn't see eye to eye on a lot of things, but he taught me about meeting needs, Chester Wickwire. And he touched my my life in his own way. And so I took a look at this, and I believe very much, and that's why I enjoy the collegiality that we have within the community of being able to do things as churches in our diversity, but it brings us the ability to come to faith together and take a look. Another reason that I think I'm a Baptist deals as it relates to our ordinances. For Lord's Supper, for me, it's a symbol. Baptism, for me, is believer's baptism, meaning at the age when God says, you have sinned, and I know that I have sinned and disobeyed, it is at that point that we baptize, and we baptize by immersion. It's not saying instead of baptism of children or something, we have dedication. Parents literally come in and dedicate and promise to raise their children in the faiths, and the church makes a commitment to help them raise it in faith. But it ultimately comes down to that issue of when I know that I have sinned and that I have disobeyed God and I need forgiveness and I ask for it, that's at the point that I accept Christ and follow his testimony and his witness of baptism. Those are some of the things that probably made me a Baptist in my journey. The other one probably is that we're not a creedal people. We believe in confessions of faith, but there is not a mandate telling us what we have to believe or not believe, that we have the ability to discern it as we understand and as we read Scripture and study it and take a look at it. Every Sunday morning, after I get through preaching, I say to my church family, go back to the Scriptures and study them. And take a look. What does it say to you? How does it speak to you? Did I speak true or did I not? The challenge is to learn and grow. We need to be lifelong learners and lifelong growers in our faith. That, I believe, deals with part of that journey of faith and the opportunity that we have. And that's why I'm a Baptist. But as a Baptist, I have the freedom to work with all other people of Christian faith to uplift the causes of Christ, to see needs and meet needs. Some things we do and some things we don't do that you do. But we come and we support and we can deal with it, much as the Interfaith Music Festival or the different ones, these opportunities, the cross-carrying, those opportunities that we come to put our faith, the point of Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, together and dealing with it. I'm a product of that faith of my parents. Not that they told me I had to be a Baptist, but they wanted me to know about Jesus Christ's love, that he died for me, that he rose again, that I have that eternal assurance that comes through faith in Jesus Christ, and that there's a place prepared. And I think that's important in dealing with it in each of us. And as my father has always said, he used to say, you have an opportunity to minister when I was a boy. He says, you're a minister at all ages. God has a place of service for all of us. And I think that's the wonderful thing. We can make a difference for our community. And I think it's at this season that we have the opportunity to walk and reflect and deal with God's love. I have something that I'm giving to my church family on Sunday, and I'll put it in the back as we leave. But for my church family, we don't normally practice Lent and the Lenten season. So starting this coming Sunday, I've given them something I call a journey of love. It's a point of putting your faith to practice in ways that you don't normally deal with it. The first part starts with the word of love. Write a note. Let somebody know you care 1 week. Another one, call somebody that you've been meaning to call and let them know that they're special, that they're important, or you thank them for their ministry. Another week, I say, please, offer a little expression, a deed, show that you care in some small way. It might be a cake, it might be a piece of cake, it might be something, but take some time to get to deal with somebody else. The following week, I said, who do you need to forgive? Maybe somebody's hurt you. Who do you need to reconcile with? Who do you need to be praying for? And the fifth week, I said, celebrate God's love. Take a moment to spend it and take a round. The danger that we have is we can lead up to the Easter season and what Christ has done, and we say, that's nice. But we need to remember that it goes on day in and day out. And so for my church family, I'm trying to encourage them to go the next couple of weeks and dealing with it tangibly, saying, thank you, God, for what you have done in Jesus Christ. So I just share it with you all, and if you'd like to, it's a challenge. Take the journey of love. We journey to the cross, and if we journey to the cross, we find love, God's love. And God's love restores us. Shouldn't we share that love with one another and others in the days ahead and the weeks that follow, so that they will know that God's love isn't a short one-time thing or one period, but it's a continuing process. Thank you. God bless you all.
Thank you, Bill. Really appreciate your coming here and giving us your own personal testimony of your own journey in faith. Now we're going to close our service with the next step with a hymn number 3. And Rob, that's... You may be seated. Let us join our hearts in prayer. Father, we pray for your universal church and for God's people throughout the world and for our own United Evangelical Church, that we may be filled with your Holy Spirit. And through the power of your Son, Jesus, we all may be one. We thank you for the ministry of Bill George tonight and for the work of his parish as they go forth to tell the great things that you have done for us all. We thank you for his gift to all of us also, for he has brought to our mind the centrality of the work of your Son, Christ Jesus, and his power in guiding and directing and shaping our lives and our work. Tonight we remember especially our brothers and sisters who are in Kosovo, those people who are working for peace. Lord, we remember the promise of your prophet Isaiah that they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks, and nation shall not lift up a sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. Work with our troops and protect them as they go forth into battle so that they can bring an end to the disgraceful behavior of the Serbs in Kosovo, and all of the wounding and the hunger and the fear and the displacement that's taking place there. Help us to be victorious in this effort to bring together peace. And now we remember those who have gone before us in the faith, and especially those in whose names memorials have been given this day and for whom love gifts have been presented, remembering especially Catherine Fisher. O God, before whom the generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your servants who, having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. And especially do we thank you for your servant, Catherine Fisher, for the gift of her life, and for the grace that you have given her, and for all that in her was good and kind and faithful. We thank you that for her death is past and pain is ended, and she has entered the joy that you have prepared through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us when we gathered together to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, we just pray for your peace. We just give thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ. And as we depart tonight, may our heart be fixed on Christ's love. May we journey in that love, and may our faith grow. In your Son's name we pray.
And now peace I leave with you, my friends, peace that the world cannot give. Peace I leave with you, my friends, so that your joy may be forever full. Be strong now and be of good courage. Fight the good fight, finish the race, and keep the faith. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you now and forever. Amen.